I'm working on a city exploration game that takes place in a procedural open-world environment, and the time has finally come to populate my city with NPCs. These models are placeholders, by the way, as I have just recently started working on them. Also, today I will only be talking about the NPC spawn and schedule system, because that's all I have to show right now. The other parts of the NPC system, such as their appearances, personalities, and player interactions, will come later when I get to them. And as usual, big thanks to my supporters on Patreon. If you like my project and would like to support it, consider checking it out. If you've been watching my previous videos, you already have an idea about how my procedural city works. But if you haven't, here's a little reminder. The city is very large in size, currently at 20 by 20 kilometers, and gets generated at runtime in rectangular chunks of varying detail. The level of detail of each area is dependent on the distance to the player. The closer an area is, the more detail it spawns. All of the detail spawns from a hierarchy of seeds that goes all the way to the master seed that you set when you start the game. So when a player leaves an area and it gets destroyed and then returns, everything spawns exactly the same as it was to maintain the illusion of persistence. This system works well for static objects from roads and buildings to the small interactive props filling the interiors. But what about dynamic objects that can move around the city, such as people? I already have vehicles zooming around the city and sky trams circulating on the tram lines, but those objects are not persistent the way they work right now. The current dynamic objects are implemented in the simplest way possible. They spawn within the player's range and get destroyed when out of range, without any attempt at persistence. Meaning, when you move too far away from a skytram line, for example, and then return to it, you won't be able to find the same tram going in the same direction on that line. Most games that take place in the city use something similar for the crowd, but I specifically want each of my NPCs to be identifiable and persistent, all while having a unique schedule of being at work, staying at home, and commuting between the two locations. And I want to do this for at least a million NPCs, as this is approximately how many it would take to make a city this size look alive. So how can I accomplish this? A million is a lot of data points to simulate in real time, and spawning NPCs selectively the way I spawn static props based on their parent chunk and the proximity to the player just won't do because they need to be in different places at different times of day and on a consistent schedule. At first, I had this idea to encode the NPC schedule and locations in its seed somehow, and then calculate the seeds of the NPCs that would be in a certain area at a certain time of day to selectively spawn them. That could work for spawning characters that are currently at their home or work locations near the player, but it wouldn't give me enough information to simulate the ones that are currently transiting through that area. And then it hit me. A million simulated data points could fit neatly on a 1024 by 1024 render target. I can simulate my entire city population on the GPU, and this is the implementation I went with. I've hard-coded the NPC schedules in HLSL using a Niagara 2D grid, which is commonly used for things like fluid simulations. And then I output this data onto a render target from which I can read the pixels to calculate which NPCs should be spawned in the player's vicinity at any time. The schedules themselves are very simple for now, and they don't have to be complex or precise. All I need from this data is to know an approximate location of each NPC so I can spawn and despawn it whenever the player is in range. And once the NPC is spawned, I can give it a more detailed behavior, such as navigation and obstacle avoidance, or any activities it should be doing at work or at home. The render target for my city's population currently looks something like this. By the way, I still consider it an early stage prototype, so this is all subject to change. For now, each pixel corresponds to a character living in the city. Its unique seed is derived from its coordinates on the canvas, as well as the city seed, so each city will have a unique set of NPCs. I put each NPC's current X and Y coordinates within the city in the red and green channel, and use the blue channel to output the current phase of its schedule. All of those values are normalized, by the way. The phase currently only has four possible values: at home, going to work, at work, and going home. You can see that I distribute the work schedules by the x-coordinate on the render target for no reason whatsoever, just to make sure that there's always an approximately equal number of NPCs at different stages of their schedule at any given time. But I've encountered a bit of a problem with this approach. At first, I tried to calculate each NPC's schedule in the most straightforward way. I picked a random coordinate within the city for its home location, and a random coordinate within a certain max distance from the home for its work location, and then linearly interpolated them for the transitions. The problem was that the NPCs would be distributed uniformly within the city without accounting for areas that should be more dense than others because they contained taller buildings, or rivers that shouldn't contain any characters at all except those commuting across. That is why I've had to add an extra step to my GPU simulation and make it take desired population density into account. In order to do this, I first need to calculate the desired population density to begin with. I don't care that much about accuracy for now, so I don't want to load the entire detailed map of the city. I only care about the rivers and major roads, and the approximate building height of each sector. The resulting density distribution looks something like this. As you can see, there's no detail on individual blocks, just the sectors and districts separated by black lines, which are roads and rivers. I might add more detail to this density map later on to account for blocks that don't contain any buildings though, such as ponds, for example. Now, we can roll our random values for home and work locations using this density distribution to make sure those locations will fall on the populated parts of the city. In order to do this, I decided to use the inverse transform sampling technique. I don't want to get into too much technical detail here on the technique itself. Feel free to look it up if you're curious. But once I have a function that calculates population density for certain coordinates within the city, I map it to a grid that spans the entire city, and then calculate the cumulative distribution function that I will need to roll a random value with this distribution. Because the city is static, I can calculate the CDF only once at the start of the game, and then pass it to the GPU where the schedules are actually calculated. But even with that, as I've mentioned before, the locations and paths calculated on the GPU are meant to be approximate. This is the lowest level at which all of the NPCs are calculated, and it is only used to determine whether they are in range of the player or not. The more detailed behaviors are meant to be calculated on the CPU, only for the NPCs that are currently in range. So the next step is to read the render target and filter its values, which correspond to the NPC's positions in the city by proximity to the player. This is not a fast operation either, that's why I only do it every few seconds, and use a separate thread to do the filtering to make sure the game thread doesn't get impacted. Once I have the IDs of NPCs in a given range and their coordinates, I can spawn them in the game world and populate their details. Right now, I am using a fairly small range that gets me about 200 to 300 characters to render at any given time, but I might be able to increase it with some optimization. Now that I have a relatively small population of characters in range, I can finally render their models, give them names and unique appearances, and more precise paths to follow. Their paths and behaviors still have to roughly correspond to the ones calculated on the GPU though, because as I mentioned before, the NPCs that are outside the player's range according to the render target get destroyed. That's why I have to keep them at least somewhat synchronized. So every time the NPC render target is read, each one of the NPCs in range receives an anchor location, which is a position they have to go to. And as the positions calculated on the GPU are approximate and don't take the precise city layout into account, I have to manipulate the anchor locations a bit to make them make sense in the game world. For example, I need to make sure that the anchor locations for the NPCs in transit fall on a walkable street and not inside a building or the middle of the road, whereas the ones for characters currently at work or at home have to be inside a building. This is why I make sure that every block in proximity has a pedestrian street graph, similar to the road graph used by the vehicles, as well as a map of buildings that can contain stationary NPCs. Then, using that information, I project the anchor locations either onto the street graph for the NPCs in transit, or the building map for the ones at work or at home before I send the character there. In order to make sure that the NPC reaches that location, I use two different modes of pathfinding. I use the standard Unreal Engine nav mesh with dynamic invokers that the NPCs can use to avoid small obstacles or navigate to the anchor that is a short distance away. But if the anchor happens to be far enough, I use the street graph to construct a path to it. But what happens if an NPC can't find its way to the anchor location by the time it moves out of the player's range? I don't want to destroy that NPC because their model might still be close to the player, and we don't want characters popping out of existence just because their anchor is far away. That's why I keep a special list of retained NPCs whose models will still be loaded and anchors will still be tracked, even if they are out of range on the render target. I sort them by the proximity to the player and cull them from time to time to make sure I don't get too many at the same time, but this ensures that an NPC that is close to the player will never be destroyed, even if they are supposed to be in a completely different spot in the city. Now, of course, if the player moves out of its range and then comes back, they won't find that NPC where they left it, and it will instead spawn at its anchor location. So that's it. This is the system that essentially creates a full population of persistent NPCs that move around. You can follow any one of them and see them arrive at their work or home location, leave them and return, and they will still be there. What you see here is a prototype that I've put together over the past month or so. And there's still a lot of work to do, both on the pathfinding to make sure the NPCs arrive at their destinations without getting stuck, and on the distribution of homes and workplaces. Right now, they only pick ground floors of buildings for their stationary locations without any regard for the interior type, but I want to allow the NPCs to take the elevator to higher floors and have their homes at actual apartment spaces. Not to mention the possibility of having more varied schedules and using vehicles to get around. Some other systems that I still need to implement will include a player interaction system, which will disconnect the character from their anchor, for example, if the player stops them to talk or makes them follow, and then return them to the anchor once the interaction is done. Then there will be the final character appearance generator and the dialogue system, for which I am also planning something very cool. Overall, I'm expecting the NPCs to take me until the end of this year to fully flesh out. But feel free to follow my channel for updates and join the Discord for discussions and feedback. Stay creative!